take a minute and talk about Congressman Tom Marino. Now, if you don't know who he is, that's all right. Do a simple Google search, find him, because we're going to be talking about him. And in order to talk about Tom today, we're going to talk about the Amash Amendment. Now, a lot of people know what that is because Americans were getting excited about it. So we'll start there. And we will get this right from the horse's mouth. Amash.house.gov. You can check it out yourself. Amash NSA Amendment Fact Sheet. Now, I want to cover this verbatim because I want you to know what it is we're talking about. On Wednesday, the House will have its first floor debate over NSA blanket collection of Americans' telephone records. The Amash Conyers Amendment, the only Amash Conyers Amendment, ends the indiscriminate collection of those records. The amendment limits the government's collection of records under Section 215 of the Patriot Act to those records that pertain to a person who is subject to an investigation under the provision. The Patriot Act, Section 215, authorizes the government to collect tangible things that are relevant, in quotes, to an authorized national security investigation. We now know the NSA used Section 215 to collect metadata on every phone call that every American has made, reportedly over the past 7 years. The metadata includes numbers dialed, numbers of incoming calls, times of calls, routing information. Many members who voted for the Patriot Act, including the past chairman of the law's authorizing committee, have stated the NSA's blanket surveillance program is far beyond what was intended by the law being, in this case, the Patriot Act. Pursuant to Section 215, and at the request of the government, the FISA court routinely enters a 90-day order to telecommunication providers like Verizon to turn over to the government all call data records or telephony metadata for calls within the United States, including purely local calls. The FISA court approves the procedures that the administration says it will impose on itself to limit its own access to the data. Yeah, everybody knows that there's a problem with that. The administration has not provided public explanation as to how the telephone records of all Americans are relevant to the national security investigation. Similarly, Section 215 is silent as to how the government may use the records once they have obtained them. What the Amash Conyers Amendment does, and this is where it gets interesting and where we get back to Tom. The Amash Conyers Amendment ends NSA's blanket collection of America's telephone records. It does this by requiring FISA court under Section 215 to order the production of records that pertain only to a person under investigation. The amendment has three important practical effects. First, it ends the mass surveillance of Americans. The government no longer is authorized under Section 215 to hold a pool of metadata on every phone call of every American. Second, the amendment permits the government to continue to acquire business records and other tangible things that are actually related to an authorized counterterrorism investigation. The government still has access to this tool under the amendment, but it is forced to comply with the intent of Congress when it is passed. Section 215. Third, the amendment imposes more robust judicial oversight of NSA surveillance. The FISA court will be involved every time NSA searches Americans' records. The court will have a substantial statutory standard to apply to make sure the NSA does not violate American civil liberties. Now, you might be thinking everybody and their brother would be for this thing. It just kind of makes sense. However, that's not the case with supposed Republican Congressman Tom Marino. Now, I know as soon as I threw the supposed in there, oh, are you going to go after Tom? Here's the deal. I don't know Tom. Not very well, anyway. I know his voting record. I know that he votes with his party 90% of the time. Yeah, I know that automatically gets him off to a rough start with most Americans, but that's just the way it is. He votes with his party 90% of the time. He's a party player. But this was his response. This was his response on Facebook. Now I'm hoping that some staffer put this up. You know, some staffer wrote it, and it wasn't actually him. And he comes out and apologizes for it. But here we go. Now that you know exactly what the Amash Amendment is. Tom's response. Like many of my constituents, I am concerned by the government's broad authority to gather intelligence and the activities of the National Security Agency to collect telephone metadata. Issues as sensitive as this require careful thought, honest debate, and as much public transparency as possible without compromising our national security. As a former federal prosecutor, I know both the value of such tools in tracking down and prosecuting those who threaten our way of life and the lengths to which those of us in the law enforcement and intelligent communities go to protect citizens from the overreach of government. Since our Constitution was adopted, ratified, and went into effect, there has always been a delicate balance between the protection of the civil liberties of individual citizens and our collective security as a nation. The Amash Amendment not only had the potential to severely hinder our intelligence-gathering capabilities, it was also potentially unconstitutional. As the Heritage Foundation noted, the amendment comes perilously close to being a violation of the principle of separation of powers. Let's just stop right there for a second. We have a clip. Before we go further in his explanation, we have a clip. I want you to hear this clip because I think it's important. Don, if you could please, sir. This is Congressman Marino talking about the use of the Patriot Act. Because this is what it all boils down to, Section 215.
Today, from my friends on the other side of the aisle, I was a U.S. attorney and used the Patriot Act. I debated it, I lectured it, and I put a terrorist away by using the Patriot Act. I was also a district attorney, and I used it. It was easier.
I'm going to suspend. The House will be in order.
There's an objection here. They'll return to him in a second. I just wanted you to bring.
Gentlemen, may continue.
I wanted you to hear the whole thing.
Thank you. It was easier for me to get a warrant for documents as a district attorney than it was for me to get documents pursuant to the Patriot Act. I just could not sign a document and go get papers and have a wiretap. I had to go through a FISA judge. It had to go through my first assistant, myself, the Justice Department, a judge, and then back to the office for a signature.
Okay, stop. Pause him right there for a second. Everybody is laughing their butt off because they're thinking, no way is a former prosecutor that ignorant. But evidently, here he is. He's saying, well, in order to get a warrant, it has to go through me and my assistant. And then we have to take it to the judge and then has to come back to the office. I mean, this is a lengthy process, folks. I'm sure he actually believes this. I don't know. Do I really want to go to McDonald's for lunch? It has to go through me. Let me think. Yes, I think I do. Now I need to tell my assistant this is a hard, strenuous process. Sally, I want McDonald's for lunch. Oh, and now she actually has to go to McDonald's. Will they deny her service? Perhaps. This is just, and then she's got to come back to the office with it. This is crazy. We need to speed this up. Well, here's the truth behind the supposed FISA judge system. Out of 7,500 requests brought before FISA judges, one was denied. One was denied. Tom, you are just hoping that people are stupid. Well, it has to go through me and then my assistant. Go to the judge and then come back to the office. Folks, don't you realize that this is just preventing us from catching terrorists? Oh, what a fool. Okay, keep going, Don.
There is absolutely no circumstances where I could get information from a citizen who we believe to be a terrorist involved with terrorism by not getting a warrant.
Pause him again. Liar, pants on fire. Turns out the NSA has been getting that information without a warrant. What do you say? Oh, yeah, we'll bring it to you. Sorry, Tom. We'll be back right after the break. All right, so this idea that I have to go to a FISA court and get them to give me a warrant, and it's not that easy. It has to go through me and then my assistant and then to the court and then back to the office. I mean, this process takes 20 minutes. I can't wait 20 minutes. Arr. And we were talking about how the court, out of 7,500 requests, they've only denied one. Turns out that was years ago. It's actually worse for you, Tom. It's worse for you. The ground is crumbling around your feet. The Wall Street Journal pointed out just this past June. Just this past June, out of the 33,900 surveillance requests now made, interesting how it went up so much in this war against terrorism. In the 33,900 surveillance requests made, the rejection rate was 0.03%. 0.03%. Thank the Wall Street Journal for that little bit of information, Tom. So here he is. I mean, let's back him up 5 seconds because I really want to get this in context, Don. Back him up 5 seconds and let him run again.
Circumstances where I could get information from a citizen who we believe to be a terrorist involved with terrorism by not getting a warrant.
That's where we left off. Okay, pause him again. Business Insider today. Why are we having the hearings today? Because the Obama administration has declassified a secret primary order. How did they use this? Well, they used Section 215 of the Patriot Act. Now, that sounds familiar. Isn't that what the Amash Amendment was trying to reallocate? Sure was. And what does this reveal to us? That there were all these circumstances in which they didn't need a warrant for warrantless wireless tapping. Now, yes, this quote or this soundbite we're playing of Tom is a little bit dated. It wasn't from last week, but he's talking about the issue that is the issue at hand here. So this whole idea, well, there's no circumstance whatsoever where I didn't need. Well, Bubba, if there wasn't a circumstance that you didn't need one, or that you needed to get approval to do this without a warrant, there's a judge who didn't like you. Because it seems very easy for the NSA to do anything they want without that FISA court saying, oh, yeah, I can't do that. And it's not if, it's not hyperbole, it's not a myth, it's admitted. They actually had to admit it now. Come on, Tom. You're better than this, man. Let's go back to Tom's letter here to his constituents. Strong checks must be in place to ensure the current and future administrations are unable to infringe upon our constitutionally guaranteed rights. Unfortunately, the Amash Amendment was overly broad and as a result could have weakened our counterterrorism and intelligence capabilities unnecessarily. Those two sentences don't match. I mean, your English professor would give you an F here, Tom. Or aid to Tom, whoever wrote this. The first sentence in this paragraph is talking about how the strong checks and balances must be there to ensure future administrations are unable to infringe upon our constitutionally guaranteed rights. Then the second segment is talking about, unfortunately, the Amash Amendment is making it a situation with weakened counterterrorism abilities. Oops, sorry, Tom. You tried to link one to the other. We're not going to let you get away with it, or at least we're not going to let your aide get away with it. And if you really think about the first sentence, then you would support the Amash Amendment, because the Amash Amendment is basically saying strong checks and balances must be in place to ensure current and future administrations are unable to infringe upon our constitutionally guaranteed rights. You know that we have just been infringed upon, Tom. You know that. That's what the discussion is about. Maybe he was absent that day. Who knows? Anyway, he goes on, unfortunately, the amendments is overly broad and weakens our counterterrorism and intelligence capabilities unnecessarily. Taking this step with such little debate would be reckless and potentially dangerous. Wait a second. Things need debate, Tom? Things need a lot of debate in order to prevent us from being careless and reckless? Well, what about H.R. 514, Tom?
Uh-oh.
Are we going to bring up H-151 or H.R. 514? February 14, 2011, Mr. Tom Marino voted on a bill that reauthorized provisions of the Patriot Act with mere minutes of debate. Minutes. Tom, you're either a liar, my friend, or you don't know what you're talking about.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Back to Tom's letter of explanation. Rather than support an amendment that would have put our country at greater risk of terrorist attack. Stop. How does this put the country at greater risk of terrorist attack? Do we need a dictionary? I think we should grab one. If we look at the risk of terrorist attack, the risk is not decreased by FISA. Not at all. Not one iota. No credible military strategist would say, yep, the FISA court reduces our risk. The only thing that reduces your risk is decreasing the size of the target or decreasing the size of the force which is trying to create the terror. At best, the only thing that this would do is decrease your ability to respond to that risk. I don't know. Just I'm a stickler for strategy and details. Anyway, he goes on, says, I supported the Nugent-Pompeo amendment, which would prohibit the collection of content contained in any communication by Americans within our border by the NSA under FISA Section 702. The amendment passed the House overwhelmingly, 409 to 12. And that's his excuse. That's his excuse. Well, let's take a closer look at this Marino guy. Marino to remain co-sponsor of SOPA, January 20th, 2012. You can find it on citizensvoice.com. Now, SOPA is that thing that real Republicans were saying, we gotta kick the teeth of this thing. This has got to stop. This is just something the founding fathers would go livid over. And people like Tom Marino should say, no, I'm going to vote against this. However, Tom decided to remain a co-sponsor. So much for wanting to protect those civil liberties, Tom. Sorry, buddy. Oh, and then we have the dangers of the Patriot Act itself. Obviously, this is something that he supports. The founding fathers went to war over things like this. But now, evidently, Republicans are all for destroying civil liberties. See, let's just back up. Let's back up, because I think what he's trying to do is he's trying to, at least I hope he's trying, otherwise it means he's inept. So I'm hoping he's trying here. He's saying, okay, in his post to the public, as much as public transparency as possible without compromising our national security. What is national security? I mean, let's just start right there. What is national security? Well, what is our nation? Our nation is a collective of people living in this territory under the Constitution, which defines the operation of the government and its impact towards this collection of individuals. That definition, then, is enhanced by what's called the Bill of Rights. Now, if that Bill of Rights is infringed upon, that is a violation of national security. Now, a violation of territory security or government security may be a lone terrorist taking out six people on a bus. Do we want that to happen? Absolutely not. But do we compromise national security in order to prevent that from happening? Absolutely not. You increase your law enforcement capabilities, you increase your tactical responses, but you do not attack the nation in order to defeat an undefined terrorist threat. And we know it's an undefined terrorist threat because the Patriot Act, Department of Homeland Security, SOPA, all these other sort of actions define terrorist activities or suspected terrorist activities as things like paying with cash at a coffee shop, having two laptops, multiple cell phones. Well, this is all terrorist suspicious activity. So we need to get back to protecting national security. If a terrorist was outside the country, you know what they would love? They would love to see things like SOPA. They would love to see things like these FISA rubber stamp approval warrants. They would love to see people like Tom Marino, because that means they're winning without actually having to blow themselves up. The goal of a terrorist is not to kill 350 million people. Not the goal. His goal is to make you so scared that you're willing to do things like reject the Amash Amendment. And once you're willing to reject things like the Amash Amendment, you're actually the terrorist ally. Once you support things like SOPA, you're the terrorist ally. You have gone against national security in lieu of maybe border security or something at best. Sorry, Tom. Your balloon just doesn't fly today, my friend. Repent, change, come back to us, man. We need smart, intelligent people to stand up for national security, the security of the people and their freedom. We'll be back right after this.